does Mike Conley support? He said 53 votes support. On Pearl 6, President, I have been working on Pearl 6 myself since, well, back in the if you want to really, if you want to voice correctly, back in the 2003, 2004, much went to the area, but that has since evolved and morphed, and the butterfly has emerged from its chrysalis itself. And now in 2017, I've been working with the actual Pearl 6 team on participating in the 14. I'm currently working at Evesaki, Romania. We are actually hiring one, if not two, up from Lutter.
And then you're on also?
Lutter, all right. I can just remember to project. We are, Evesaki, Romania is hiring one, if not two, Pearl permits. We are in. We got a nice property here that may be actually appropriate for time for Pearl 6. Just to tease everyone, the bandwidth out there is wonderful. I am right now, I have a, let's see, 10 euro a month, gigabit fiber. So you got plenty of bandwidth. Come on. All right. First of all, those of you that don't know, where to find Pearl 6, we have Pearl 6 on board. Pearl 6 on board is where the software is. Docs.pearl6.org. You can find documentation online. There's also pearl6.net and Pearl 6 with the .net in the language. Module supporting five modules for Pearl, or you can use Ceph. We used to hard hand it, but now Ceph gives you Ceph to modules, which means much like CPAN or Pearl 6. Right there is my current, somewhat outdated right now website. I have right now a fleet that's up there is a four-part article on frame instructions. So go on out and take a look at that. So, my current talking schedule does fill people in, where you see more stuff on Pearl 6 Live. First of all, there is a webcast coming up on Tuesday with a meeting for Pearl 6. I will also be at Open Source Days in Copenhagen. Follow that in Dev Days in Vilnius, Lithuania. After that, heading out to Oslo, Holly, given the situation, who knows? Obviously, going out to Amsterdam and DC for conferences. So that's how busy I'll be over the next year. Those of you with your laptops out, I'll ready to download the module. This is where you look for the Pearl 6 password within Pearl 6. Now, at one time, there was a meeting started by, probably started by either Randall Schwartz or Adam Kennedy, that Pearl 5 cannot be parsed by anything but Pearl 5, which is not entirely true. If Pearl 5 could be parsed by Pearl 5, then why is Pearl 5 in C? Albeit a back row variety of Z with a lot of layers. Pearl 6 on the other hand, yes, you could parse it with other languages, but it's so much easier to parse it with this stuff. So that's what this mod does. If you want to download and play with it yourself, you need to use Panda or the Ceph installers. I think Ceph PC install keyword. I have not used myself. Now, the question is, why would you want to use one? Here is a sample test. A sample test. Parser.format my $i equal 1. Test to see if it is my $i equal 1. So it's just taking a string and returning a string, which on the face of it is really, really silly. If so, why does it take 166 seconds to run the test? This is on a VM located back in the U.S. on part of a Wino network. So that's part of why this does for most of it is file I/O, as you can see by 23 sub files. So I assure you, it is very fast, as you see here, 0.06 second I think you've, a lot of use times popping out, it's the beginning of whether that can be going on. But why would you take a string and just return three? There's no point there. Well, let's take a look briefly at what's actually under the hood. This is in the equivalent in Perl 5, a reconstruction to parse, a very simple statement, my $i equal 1, and to try to break it out into pieces. You find out what the my keyword is, you find out the very thing, check that, ignore the equal sign, and capture the 1 there as a number. This is all in Perl 5. Everyone should probably get off all ones. B slash X there, let's add white space here, and check it, and add white space over there. So, hold it in. So, there's no real problem trying to parse this. But, we'll move now into Perl 6, and change a few things. And do parsing inside Perl 6. We haven't changed that much so far. Now, here's a slide here. We do see familiar old equal tilde command for operator. And we have the slash x modifier. We'll hopefully know about all that as we go to Perl 5. In Perl 6, you drop out the rules for tilde. And you don't need the x. Everything else remains the same. Aside that. So this is one way as when you get into how to wipe the code in Perl 5 over to Perl 6. Here, what you must do on the side. So what we are doing here with the Perl 6 parse model is we call this thing, but we're using Perl 6 inside itself, effectively freeing the code as we enter. So what is actually happening at this point, we call the for method, it is actually calling back to the power inside the power to do the work and returning the match object with either the process. Now, if you're going through and doing a compiler and trying to compile the statement, there are some things that you really don't need to worry about. You don't need to worry much about the richness of your mind. You don't need to worry about the fact that it is a new line because we're trying to match a time structure. All you're going to serve up here is the variable and the number 1. So, when I get the match back from the compiler, all it's returning me, this isn't quite correct, as I understand, all it's returning me is the variable here and the expression value. All this training. So when I try to take this instruction, parse it down, break it down, or reassemble back, what I end up with looks more like this in Perl 6. You have an actual variable name here for the variable. You have integer here for the integer. And this is closer to what is going on inside the power. And this is some of the now, when we have this expression over here, my $i equal 1, and you want to return that in some format. Say you want to pretty good that. You want to get rid of the white space there between the equals line, yes. Or say you want to put a tab in there. Or say you want to use all the epochler symbol on the left-hand side. One expression. You can do that using this model. So, how does it all work? Let's think a little bit deeper under the hood here. And start out by, instead of using the format gene, let's look at the built-in parse routine. The dot here, for those of you that don't know, is much like in Java and many other languages. The dot is the new black, the new arrow. You reference an object. So the dot here is representing you don't hear because you receive nothing. And I will throw in a little bit of a little more Pearl 6X here with the dash. We finally got that add, and I tend to use that a lot more than most people do because I want to A, make sure it doesn't go away. As we all know, once you use feature in core, then it never goes away. We don't know that for Pearl 5. We have many features in Pearl 5 that can't go away because they've been used for 25 years. Well, hidden away under the hood. So, what we're doing here is we are doing the parsing, and we get back a data stream. Which in this case, again, it all comes in from the compiler inside the compiler. I won't show you that code because it's bound to change here over the next few years once we get a proper macro set up and once we get the abstract syntax predefined, which is what this module is experimenting to. So we parse our statement, turn a data tree. I will show you some of that in just a second. And then we dump that out. And what we get in our case, this piece here, I have to say, is a very straight, hopefully very straightforward, simple way to view our data tree. First of all, the entire thing here is a document. If you've ever worked with API in Chrome or Chrome, you'll recognize the input of the bound tree. This function is a document. So this statement here is a document. Starting with the document. Inside the document is one or more statements down here. The segment, this is all for my internal human purposes. This tells me one more line is we use the same object. Very important for debugging. And inside the segment we have a enormous statement. Followed by a variable object or my. It tells me exactly a start object 0 over here. 0 is my logical. Over 2 object 2 over here by the my. And we generate it online 592. Again, very handy when something breaks and you have to go and trace a large problem. Trace on the source statement. Because by this time, is counting and parsing and returning states as complex as this. So if there is a white space out place somewhere within that, I have to either debug that through a long stack trace in Pearl 6, or just look at, or just go right to the line of, or the arrays. So fast error tracing, fast debugging, and the routine to generate this is maybe 45 months long. Well, internally, what I'm trying to make sure that this becomes a core routine because I'm hoping that someone out there out of the room or I'll be here myself, whichever, is someone will build on top of this, say, a stack data focus, or you build a stack highlighter, or you can use it to build a new version of Pearl 6 Primitive. Can be built on top of this. By taking our statement here and bring it down into pieces and reassembling pieces. So, internally as well, there is a lot of validation because right now, hopefully, the grammar is kind of set, but we can change terms now either. So what I want to make sure of is that every piece of the program is counted. So one of the steps I do is very intense validation. I make sure that 0 is for 2, the next token has to start at number 2, program is 3, has to start with 3, so the entire thing has to fall down. So 5, 6, right there is a plus. I'm sorry, 6, 7, 7, 2, 8, 9, and so on, until the last line. And white space is also preserved. So if you want to say write in crayon printer, if you want to go through and pick up my and draw an equal sign, you can do that, sure. But if you want to just return everything as it was, the module preserves all placements, even including gear dogs. Gear dogs are a very special case because the gear dog content has to go up here, but the gear dog content has to appear here, but it actually in real-life code appears down there at the end of the sticker. So I create a separate blank though down here that does nothing but holding gaps. So that's the reason behind it. Now, let's take a look at the next portion of this will be largely trying to describe why it's useful for e-books in Perl 5 community to go out and at least look at some of the features that Perl 6 offers. Now, as you can tell by looking at the base structure document here, statement, all these are Perl 6 classes. Now, note here that we have a variable class, which just contains one single thing, a single content field, the word my. The entire statement, however, includes a list of multiple variables and place space and operators. So we have essentially a root element, which is either a bare word or a complex of bare word, combination of bare words and listings, a serum, which is okay. You can easily do that as an inheritance or sort of feature. And if you want to, even in Perl 5, you could just drop out the replace the class here with packet and use loops and add as at child as dollar content or so. You can do that really easily. So you have a variable here with a single content type and an operator here with a single content type. And over here you have a statement which has a list of things. So the question really becomes here, how do you kind of reconcile both of these? Because if you want to have just a single overarching element class over all these, well, you have a, you create your own class element and the statement is a, and the statement is a element, or is a element, which is fine. The problem comes when you're trying to take these two attributes here and move them up into your parent class, because of course you want to have nested classes across the board. So if you had an overall a mythical element class, which had a file and a content, when time comes to validate her, when time comes to run the testament, what you want to make sure of is that your bare words can only contain one thing, that your statements will only contain a list of things. And the best way to do that is, of course, to have several classes. But you always said you want a overarching class. So how do you reconcile that? And when you add in things like a medical full parent list, that becomes even more complex because it has both the name food and the parent list over here. So you have a combination of the list of triad children and the original content, like so. So how do you reconcile those? Well, again, you can do this in Perl 5 too, by using robots.
Look at your actual, it doesn't work.
Oh, okay. So what we use here is roles. Roles you can get in Boots, in Perl 5, and in Perl 6 you get them for free. They're essentially a slice of a class. Is how I like to do it. So what I've done here, instead of having a whole bunch of classes and then having all the content inside the classes. What I've done is I've taken the classes that we had here, these listings, and where we have a child, I create a branching role. So a child, so a student has branches on it. Over here for the bear warden, the bear warden only has one thing, so instead of having a conflict between the two, between a tree and a single point, what I've done is created a naming role so that the bear word only have bear word does naming and the segment does branching. Now, I have to follow the, we're starting still to figure out how to do, we're starting to figure out still how the Perl 6 best practices will be. But I find that if you're naming roles and classes, naming roles at least in English, you can use the name, you can use the adjective over here, branching, naming, debugging. It reads very nicely. Class statement does branching. Or you could say class statement does branch and sort of falls off the end. So what we got here is the content side naming. So right here, the bear word only has a name variable. Inside, the operator only has a name. And these are the only two ways that you can build the tree so that there are no other bits of data going around. And likewise, if you want to go to for a method call, i.e. method parent list, method parent list, you can have it do a name for the method, and for the list, you do the branch. We have both the element node and the branch as well. So, it's not so much a way to create a slice for the class here as a way to help validate and make sure that your tree is consistent. Here, which I find, again, very handy. Because one of the things that, because going back to Perl 5, one simple thing, if we have, say, Perl 5 package, we'll call it a factory package that does stuff. Inside here we have some debugging terms where we have dump text and dump term, and we have the real read, which is the match doc method. What else happens isn't. Now, in Perl 5, there's a whole bunch of ways to comment out your code, of course. At least two common ways. You can also use pound signs at the top, comment out that way, or use your docs. The old people who like so. The old people who blah, 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 cut. But we all know that once we write the code, okay, suppose here we have down, suppose here later on in debugging, we have a subroutine down here. So we have, so in order to comment all of our debugging that we want to do before pushing production, you have to comment out here and skip that bit right there and then comment more down there. Well, the roles there are come to the rescue. Because in this case, what you can do is take your debugging methods, here, dump text, dump term, the Perl 6 term, put those into a role, and add that to your class. So now, when you want to comment out all of your debugging, instead of find a equal bar or pound sign, you go into your class and comment out right there at one point. So you remove your debugging, you can remove any sort of validation or backtracing with one line, instead of having to change packages and add roles and whatnot. And as a front bonus, if you want to make sure that you can't see the role hidden outside of your class file, few units high because now classes and roles and everything can be partially scoped. So now we have our method. Already, if you're like me and a hardcore Vim user, you know the keyword to get around the paragraph and to go from place to place. So it becomes very easy. You jump from here to here and jump down past your code or select your entire playing role in one fell swoop without having to worry about, okay, did I put this down here? Is there more people down there? Is there validation stuff up here that I need to worry about? You don't need to worry about that. Put it all aside, one role, patched away, is hidden away in another class, in another role rather, and come in out, and it's in one module block in your code. Okay, now, you might, after taking a look at this huge tree, and wondering, okay, so how do you want this thing? How do you get your output? If I want to rewrite, if I want to write my own format, how do I do that? How do I take this string, get this tree out, and how much work is it that you want this to get out to get your text out? Well, it is just that easy. That is all I/O that you need. This is the entire method to return a string. With all that data store time, with all those methods, all those objects going on, this is all you need to turn your Perl 6 code back from the data store into Perl 6. That's it. I'm trying to deliberately make this as simple as can be. I'm showing the code only uses the fastest constructs I use in the code are render expressions and if and else, and given when. Those are the most complex things I use in the code. I probably should replace a lot of stuff with index calls to optimize, but not to worry about that right now. Now, I mentioned before code formatting. So if you have this two-string routine that returns the content, returns the word my from a bare word, or returns, in this case, a list of all things in the building. And by the way, now you can kind of see why it's important to have roles and to separate tasks so that the bare word call doesn't accidentally do this, or why the statement can never return the content. Because then you're crossing streams, and Egon told us crossing streams is bad. So if you want to write your own format, if you want to say get rid of all white space, that's it. Remove all white space in your Perl code with less than a line code. The bang till field here is matching the type for 6 us. And this is all that you need to write your own format. If you want to ignore white space, that's fine. If you want to skip over, if you want to replace white space with your own, then return what they return how much white space, followed by the operator, followed by more white space. So that's all you have to do to write your own paper. That's it. So, back to Leo, and back to Perl 5, a little bit. We've all been here. We have a call here that does something that's broken. We need to find out what's going on, and we need feedback. Hands up here, how many people use data network for this? Okay, those of you that use YAML or JSON. Okay, I'm also in a minority. I bring out myself. But, so you would add, so this was very pushed, I'm sure. Use the dumper, get the stuff, get the data, bad stuff, get the dumper file. Everything, copacetic, no problem. But if the time comes to you want to commit the get commit or BCR commit, and you forget to remove the print double mode. Been there, done that, made on. I don't know about you. Been there, done it. Also, over here you got this huge data line, and someone eventually is going to look at that and wonder, okay, why do you have a data dumper routine when you don't actually call that data line? Is something deeper in the code that I'm missing? No, you just forgot to remove it after you booked. Well, no, 66 that way from you. If you need to debug statements, that's it. There's no need for using YAML, or there's no need for pressure modules, there's no need for callbacks, no need for dumper, no need for YAML. You simply return the code, just unquote, of the data structure. You can also use .perl, and it will return the Perl, you'll return a version of the Perl intro script. That's it. There is nothing above here. And you search around for the word .gist or the word .curl if you prefer. And remove those from any button. Keeps it very, very straightforward. Coming. I lose it beforehand. In Perl 5, there's a bunch of ways to come in after Perl. You can use sound size, sub document, blah, 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 blah. The content noise here is not. The important thing is row or power size down the side. You can do things this way in Perl 5. If you're fancier, you can use here for comment, cut, and hopefully you'll remember to add the blank lines there, because otherwise, the Perl 5 pod will triple. Put that into your documents. And when someone goes Perl doc your module, they'll see this debug inside there, and they shouldn't. Well, that's okay too. If you use, say, Atom or Eclipse or Emacs or Vim, they all have grown up and evolved to have, you know, pound markers. They have a Meta X common outline. Or a Meta X add for tag. The problem, though, is that most of those editors haven't quite caught to the way Perl does format. In Perl 5, Perl 6, what sort of? In C, say, you have slash star, dot, 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 star, slash. C, Vim, and EX, and Atom all know how to jump between the start and end of that one. When it comes to Perl, jumping from the equal sign to another equal sign to another equal sign, they get confused. At least Vim does. You can add highlighting to be sure, no problems. You can add your own highlight markers, you can add your own business code to go in and change how the error was. But really, it's better to use the principles of Hugo and roll with the editor. So when it comes out, you turn it. And you all know how you jump from the start of the marker to the end in Vim is percent. In Emacs, I think it's meta point, meta dollar sign, if you jump between that. I don't know about this. But in Perl 6, we saw that. You have the comment marker here with a back in there, jump there, down there. So here we are using the address mapping tendencies to want to balance things. The program's map tendency to balance items, like so. We're working with them. And also, the fact that we have a backtick there makes it very much easier to go through a test, saying, if you use this format to comment out test flights. If you use this comment out test sections, if you want to know how many things you comment out, all you do is backtick type WC, return the number of lines that have the backtick. So you know how many more tests to have. That's why I sat down and developed the Perl 6 template. which ends on something like 27 plus files, 230 odd tests, and I'm now down to maybe 20 tests left. So speaking of testing, there's two ways to go about doing this, or rather, two ways to go about solving a problem like this. Either write a test suite and you have some stuff in there that is not necessarily things that are often only, like, say, in my model, I have a lot of stuff there that is validation for me currently, but I do want someone to be able to run that. In Perl 5, what you do, Natalie, is declare an environment variable, say, strict or author, and have code inside there, and it does stuff. But the thing is, but of course, a couple things here to point out. The first thing here is that obviously if blah 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 in line in your code is going to slow things down. At least in Perl 5. Also, you gotta remember and look around for the EMV variable to look up what you did for the author debugging every time that you go through, or to say, okay, it's always offered or always something. The other thing here is that this is actually over inside your core package. So this is not inside the test file. This is not working inside the module. And you want to keep a separation line between your debugging stuff and the rest of the world. Well, the line gets a little bit blurry. You have this going on over here in test, and you have this going on over here in your application code. So, we've got this environment variable dependency going on outside that you don't really want to use. So, again, Perl 6 comes to the rescue with constant of the dynamic variable. So, you'll see here, this is a fellow slide variable. You get us a regular variable inside your method, but it's not cleared anywhere. There's no Y here, so there should be Y up there, I apologize. There's no Y or star script over there. Nothing like that. This is over in your code, and this is over here in your test. So what happens is Perl 6 says, all right, star, anything with the star sign is a dynamic variable and can be declared anywhere. So instead of declaring the variable inside your package here and clearing up your namespace, using %EMV to communicate information around, you don't want your namespace cluttered because it will be a big debugging VM. And you must remember too that Perl 6 is not compiled, so if we have a way to simply eliminate that, then your code runs much faster. In Perl 5, if you say ifu, you always got test that value. In Perl 6, you have this. So it's not passive. You simply read it as a flight. I shouldn't use the word script there, I apologize. Dollar script. My post there. So this is over here, and automatically a other portion of the program triggers the hidden debug code. So you out there as the user never need to know about this. If you look there, you might see the dollar star. But you don't need to worry about that. It won't impact your button. Another compound that I see in a lot of, at least 5 Perl 5 code that I keep updating and keep updating and evolving as I move more into Perl 6. I'm already to the point where I moved past the point where I dropped out the errors in my Perl 5 code. I went now down over that and have some vitalized, so Perl 6, I don't use the errors in Perl 5, I still do. So we're kind of closing on the end here. The last pattern I see and resolve, this can be resolved in 524, I think. In Perl 5, you have a point column pattern here. I'm sure we've all had to use that one for another. You want to print this stuff out, but you want out all entries. Okay, good. All right. Okay, let's that's good.
Okay.
Okay. Well, fine enough. All right. Well, let's do that. I will bring. I'll list down to the last picture. So Ducup Chase here. The pair that we have here in Pearl 6 with Lois and Pearl 5. They have Infinix and this stuff up. And we're now down to that. So you have your pick. So instead of having both, instead of having both the index and the bird and now we use the two dark pair to take the index and the one pair. So I know we'll have that probably likely from the old one I know. And again, I have a more relic coming up on the 7th, which is a Viper pair.
Oh, you want to live?